If one were to peel back the layers of American history, one might expect to find countless tales of courage, sacrifice, and perseverance. They might expect to see stories of the country's revolution, a fight against unfair taxation, and towards the dream of independence, freedom, and self-servitude. They might expect to see the bittersweet effects of bloodshed and the Civil War, which saw the end of institutionalized slavery, or the growth of the country through land acquisition and migrating adventure. They might expect to see the vital hand we lent to foreign nations during the Great War and the quest for peace against dictators during World War II. They might expect to see the attempts of thwarting totalitarianism in Asia and the Soviet Union through the Cold War and its related conflicts dotting the eastern continents. However, what they probably don't expect to see is the inherent violence and costs of battle within its own borders, including the disturbing war crimes and underreported massacres against certain demographics, including the Native American populations of the 19th century. One such tragedy in question was the Sand Creek Massacre of 1864, its victims, the endgame of Civil War fallout, and the treatment towards the Plains Native Americans in the years leading up to the mid-1860s. To shed some light on one of the U.S. Army's darkest moments and one of the least discussed war crimes during the heyday of the Wild West, here is a close inspection of the Sand Creek Massacre and the destruction of the Cheyenne tribes in the Great Plains of America. The roots of the Sand Creek Massacre spread all the way back to the aftermath of the Treaty of Fort Laramie in 1851. When the United States recognized land ownership of territory between the North Platte River and the Arkansas River to the north and south, and between the Rocky Mountains and western Kansas to the east and west. The treaty involved seven Native American tribes, including the Cheyenne and the Arapaho. They lived in the land that constitutes present-day Wyoming, Nebraska, Colorado, and Kansas, as well as other territories, and felt the treaty was their best chance at maintaining sovereignty over their homeland. The feel-good nature of the treaty was short-lived, however, when the Pikes Peak Gold Rush changed the landscape of settler-indigenous relations at the end of the decade. In 1858, gold was discovered in Colorado's Rocky Mountains. These lands were occupied by the Cheyenne and the Arapaho tribes at the time, and saw their resources depleting by the day from plenty of prospectors and other migrating parties attempting to get rich quickly. Of course, the mining camps and prospecting caravans weren't going to go away anytime soon, and officials of the burgeoning Colorado Territory pushed the Commissioner of Indian Affairs to resolve a new treaty that would change the borders of indigenous land. Thus, the Treaty of Fort Wise was born in February of 1861, which saw the Council of six Southern Cheyenne tribes and four Arapaho tribes come together with the United States, ceding much of the land given to them by the Treaty of Fort Laramie. The new land amounted to about 1/13th the size of the former land swath and was located in present-day eastern Colorado. The Treaty of Fort Wise was generally unpopular with many Cheyenne tribesmen. It especially ruffled the feathers of the Dog Soldiers, a warrior band of Cheyenne and Lakota Native Americans, who felt the lack of a blessing from Council of 44 was damaging to the livelihood of all the Cheyenne and surrounding tribes. The Dog Soldiers and other dissenters did not let their distaste go unnoticed. Some of the warrior bands threatened the chiefs who signed the treaty, upset that they had not taken into consideration the desires of the tribes at large, and felt that they had been swindled into the deal by the quantity of gifts handed over by U.S. officials. In retaliation, Dog Soldiers and Company took their frustrations out on the migrating settlers coming in through the territory. Many Cheyenne tribes remained in eastern Colorado and western Kansas to hunt the American buffalo that remained, scaring off wagon trains and the white pioneers crossing into gold country through intimidation. Of course, the ruffled feathers eventually drew the attention of the U.S. government, who heard of the Cheyennes clamoring for war and appointed then-governor of the Colorado Territory, John Evans, to engage in further peace talks with the Cheyenne and Arapaho chiefs. When the chiefs did not attend the summoning, all hope for sustained peace was lost. The conflict between the Plains tribes and the settlers only increased from there. The beginning of 1864 saw a relationship form between warrior bands of the Sioux, Comanche, Kiowa, Cheyenne, and Arapaho tribes in an attempt to push their white counterparts from their country. This heightened the ill will between the indigenous and the immigrants, and led to increased instances of violence. One such escalation came in May of 1864. A few bands of Cheyenne were camping at Ash Creek on a break during a buffalo hunt. The 1st Colorado Regiment lurked nearby, and one of the Cheyenne peace chiefs, named Lean Bear, attempted to make good with the enemy faction. Lean Bear approached the regiment by himself, his peace medal clearly strapped around his neck, as to show his peaceful intentions to the U.S. soldiers. He also came equipped with a letter from Washington, D.C., and signed by President Lincoln himself, declaring his peaceful nature and friendliness with white folk. Unfortunately for Lean Bear, the 1st Colorado Regiment had recently been given orders by a former Union Army commander, named Colonel John M. Chivington, to kill Cheyennes whenever and wherever found. Lean Bear was then shot point blank by the soldiers, riddled with bullets as he fell to the ground. As the months wore on, so did the conflicts. At this point, the U.S. government's focus remained solely on the Civil War to the south and defeating the Confederate Army. As a result, military support waned in the Western territories after 1861, peaking in around the summer of 1864. Without any sort of widespread protection hanging over the Western settlements, nearly every wagon train, stagecoach, and small town were at severe risk of being raided or plundered by dog soldiers and other warrior bands of Cheyenne, still angry at their loss of land rights 6 years prior. With the Western territories struggling to maintain a proper defense, Governor Evans called upon the Secretary of War to send reinforcements. Unable to procure anyone from the front lines in the South, Evans was left with no choice but to create his own faction of 3rd Colorado Volunteers. The 3rd Colorado Volunteers, officially called the 3rd Colorado Cavalry Regiment, was a military unit made up of men committing to 100-day enlistments. It was led by the aforementioned Colonel John Chivington. Chivington was a former minister and Union commander who rose to fame with his heroics during the Battle of Glorieta Pass in New Mexico. He had longed for a future in politics and to serve the United States Congress after the war concluded. Of course, these goals meant following whatever orders were handed down to him, and despite his abolitionist stance on slavery, he did not share any sympathies for Native Americans. He took his duties with the 3rd Colorado Cavalry to heart, and worked hard to shed the regiment's label of the Bloodless Third due to their relative inactivity and lack of claimed casualties. It wouldn't be long before Colonel Chivington would act on his grand scheme. In July of 1864, the warrior bands of Cheyenne, Arapaho, and other Plains tribes making their presence known in the Colorado Territory knew they couldn't continue upholding conflict through the impending winter. They felt that if they made attempts at peace throughout the cold season, they could stock up on resources and continue their offense the following spring. Meanwhile, the actual Cheyenne and Arapaho peace seekers were attempting the same quest at quelling the embattled Western tribes. They were alerted by a notice sent to tribal camps by Governor John Evans that all indigenous peoples could come together at Fort Lyon in southeastern Colorado for lodging, food, and protective services. It didn't happen immediately, but the peacekeeping chiefs, led by Black Kettle, White Antelope, Bull Bear, and One Eye, eventually sought out Governor Evans in Denver to inquire about the deal proposed at Fort Lyon on September 28, 1864. It was here White Antelope made his anxieties well known to Evans at the meeting, telling the governor he was worried his people were in danger, being so close to the soldiers at Fort Lyon and the surrounding settlements. Governor Evans confirmed the danger was imminent, and revealed that total peace was not possible under the current circumstances. Evans stated that the tribes had their wartime advantages in the summer, whereas his wartime advantages would arrive in the winter. "My time is coming," he is reported to have said. The rest of the peacekeeping chiefs pressed the governor for any and all promises of safety he could procure, to which Evans responded by introducing Colonel Chivington to the council. Chivington was amused by the peace talks, and told the men that if they truly wanted peace, they'd come to Fort Lyon and speak to Major Ed Weinkoop, who was sympathetic to the efforts of protecting indigenous peoples. Immediately following the peace parley, the tribal leaders went back with the understanding that peace could be obtained as long as they made right with the soldiers themselves, and beset on their settlements symbols of peace, so that passing U.S. regiments would not attack without notice. At the same time, Governor Evans doubled down on the two orders that had become mainstays within the Colorado Territory. All friendly Cheyenne and Arapaho must go to Fort Lyon to find supplies, while all Native Americans who didn't comply were to be killed and destroyed, especially those deemed violent and hostile by the state. Thus, Black Kettle was left with no choice but to bring his band of Southern Cheyenne to Big Sandy Creek in eastern Colorado, a relocation point decided upon at the peace parley. He was joined by Chief Left Hand of the Arapaho, along with a few of his own tribe. These bands consisted of mostly women, children, and elderly men. The Dog Soldiers and other warrior sects of the tribes remained at their original camps up north, unthreatened by the territory's political charades. Some retreated further to join the Sioux bands that had flocked to the Dakota Territory. This meant at least 75 or more able-bodied men would be missing from the Big Sandy Creek encampment, exposing the tribes to military attacks and leaving behind very little by way of security. At first, this wasn't seen as an issue by Black Kettle and the rest of leadership. They truly believed their conversation with Governor Evans and Colonel Shivington was a quote-unquote gentleman's agreement, despite no treaty being signed. Little did they know that around the same time they wrapped up the peace talks at Camp Weld outside of Denver, Colonel Shivington received a telegram from his superior, General Samuel Curtis, that read, "I want no peace till the Indians suffer more. No peace must be made without my directions." Colonel Shivington took the order seriously and continued on his descent on indigenous villages around eastern Colorado. He had already managed to raise encampments of the Sioux, Comanche, and Kiowa in the surrounding territories, and saw the weakened Cheyenne and Arapaho tribes as the perfect opportunity to continue his violent conquest. In late November of 1864, Colonel Shivington and the 3rd Colorado Cavalry, consisting of around 425 men, rode into Fort Lyon, teaming up with 250 men of the 1st Colorado Cavalry and a few volunteers of the New Mexico Infantry. From there, they marched towards Big Sandy Creek, where Black Kettle and 200 or less Cheyenne and Arapaho were sanctioned. The night before Shivington's planned raid on the Big Sandy Creek camp, three members of the faction approached Shivington with disputes about the attack. The dissenters consisted of Captain Silas Sewell, Lieutenant Joseph Kramer, and Lieutenant James Connor, who all felt the offensive would bring dishonor to the U.S. Army and violate the human rights of the indigenous. Shivington scoffed at his inferior's pleas for surrender and directed his men to continue towards Big Sandy Creek. On the morning of November 29, 1864, Shivington ordered an attack on every single occupant of the Sand Creek camp. As he and his men approached the encampment, they saw both an American flag and a white flag standing tall in the middle of camp. Black Kettle had raised the symbols of peace and surrender when the cavalries were spotted, hoping they would be enough to signal that they had no intention to attack or cause problems. Of course, Shivington ignored the peaceful gesture and ordered his men to attack. Meanwhile, Captain Sewell and Lieutenant Kramer of Company D and Company K ordered their men to hold back and cease fire, unwilling to be a part of the atrocities that were yet to come. It didn't take long for menace and murder to consume the Cheyenne and Arapaho. Shivington and his men started killing as quickly as they could, targeting even the women and the children. Black Kettle, White Antelope, and the other elders begged for peace and urged their fellow tribesmen to run. A few of the luckier Cheyenne were able to run away after releasing their horses from their pens, hopping on top of their unsaddled broncos in hopes to avoid the cannon fire that rained mercilessly down on Big Sandy Creek. Others who were fortunate enough to escape dug deep holes in the sand on the banks of the stream, hiding in the trenches to avoid capture and protect themselves from stray bullets. Generally speaking, however, most of the folks in the camp were unable to get away safely. If they weren't killed immediately, many of the Cheyenne and Arapaho were beaten senselessly and left to die. The women and elders were then mutilated, their body parts and scalps becoming trophies for the attacking U.S. regiments. Later, quotes given by men who witnessed the massacre would make their rounds through written reports and congressional hearings on the matter. John S. Smith described what he saw in his 1865 testimony. "I saw the bodies of those lying there cut all to pieces, worse mutilated than any I ever saw before. The women cut all to pieces, with knives. Scalped, their brains knocked out. Children 2 or 3 months old, all ages lying there, from sucking infants up to warriors. By whom were they mutilated? By the United States troops." Robert Bent was later interviewed by the New York Tribune in 1879, quoted as saying, "I saw one woman lying on the bank, whose leg had been broken. A soldier came up to her with a drawn saber. She raised her arm to protect herself. He struck, breaking her arm. She rolled over and raised her other arm. He struck, breaking that, and then left her without killing her. I saw one woman cut open, with an unborn child lying by her side." Major Anthony provided one of the most damning quotes for the same Tribune paper, stating as follows. "There was one little child, probably 3 years old, just big enough to walk through the sand. The Indians had gone ahead, and this little child was behind, following after them. The little fellow was perfectly naked, traveling in the sand. I saw one man get off his horse at a distance of about 75 yards and draw up his rifle and fire. He missed the child. Another man came up and said, 'Let me try the son of a bitch. I can hit him.' He got off his horse, kneeled down, and fired at the little child, but he missed him. A third man came up and made a similar remark, fired, and the little fellow dropped." Even after the camp had been burnt to the ground and most of its inhabitants were slain, Shivington and his men returned to Big Sandy Creek a second time after the smoke had cleared to collect more severed body parts and genitalia of the murdered Cheyenne and Arapaho. The soldiers also used the opportunity to execute any and all straggling survivors, bringing back a few of their own that had been wounded by friendly fire in the process. In the end, it is still argued to this day exactly how many Native Americans lost their lives in the Sand Creek Massacre. Some accounts have the number at 70, while others have it closer to 230. Generally, it's understood that over 100 of the casualties were women and children, while anywhere from 30 to 50 men were murdered as well. The U.S. Army saw much smaller casualties, with only a few killed and a few dozen wounded. Some historians have since claimed that these numbers are only as high as they are because many of Shivington's men were drunk both the night before and the morning of the raid, ultimately engaging in friendly fire. Eventually, Shivington and his men retreated with the entire camp destroyed, the horses divided up amongst the commanding officers, and the horrors at Big Sandy Creek became just a memory. That is, for everyone but those who survived to tell the tale. The evening after the attack, the Cheyenne and Arapaho, who had taken shelter in the sands of the stream bank, retreated from their holes and walked upstream to stay the night. They had no shelter, and many of the survivors were wounded, but had to push forward if they were to make it up to the Cheyenne camp at Smoky Hill River unscathed. Overall, the entire power structure of the Cheyenne tribe was irreversibly damaged. 8 chiefs, including White Antelope and One Eye, were killed, as well as a few other societal headmen of the Cheyenne military. Black Kettle had managed to escape unharmed. However, his wife had been shot multiple times, and he cared for her in the immediate aftermath. The rest of the surviving Cheyenne leadership were amongst those who didn't side with the peacekeeping council in the first place. They saw the massacre as an unforgivable act by the U.S. government, and felt there was no other option henceforth other than to side with the Dog Soldiers and other warriors to strike back against the white settlers once and for all. Now, the Dog Soldiers saw their efforts in the previous decades of raiding and plundering the pioneers as justified. they felt their adamant stance on fighting back against the U.S.'s encroachment on their land rights and their contradicting treaties was not fully understood by not only their fellow Cheyenne, but now by surrounding Plains tribes as well. As a result, the traditional leadership system utilized by the Cheyenne was all but wiped out by the Sand Creek Massacre, if it hadn't been already by the 1849 cholera epidemic and the growing presence of dog soldiers splitting off from the various bands. In an act of retaliation, the Cheyenne dog soldiers were joined by surviving bands of Arapaho and other rogue Cheyenne warriors. Together, they enacted vengeance on settlements all over the Platte Valley. These acts of revenge targeted military locales, such as Fort Casper, Wyoming, and Camp Rankin in Colorado. They also contributed to raids along the South Platte River, collecting loot in Julesburg before trekking northeast towards the Black Hills. The lone survivor of the Sand Creek Massacre who maintained his quest for peace with the United States was Black Kettle, who refrained from joining the dog soldiers and moved to Powder River Country. Here, he started a journey to the Arkansas River to start a renewed peace talks with the folks of Colorado, before being murdered in the Battle of Washita River in 1868. On the other side of the offensive, Colonel John Chivington and his men rode into Denver in the days following Sand Creek, overflowing with pride and pieces of Cheyenne and Arapaho corpses. They declared the massacre was in fact a battle between soldiers and warriors, and that blood had been shed in the name of victory for the U.S. Army. The scalps and various other body parts the soldiers had collected were hung up around Denver in saloons and theaters, hanging like trophies. Citizens cheered for regiments, who were heroes in the eyes of the ignorant. Colonel Chivington led the charge in claiming the massacre as a military success story. He wrote to his superiors in the aftermath, stating, "At daylight this morning, attacked Cheyenne village of 130 lodges, from 900 to 1,000 warriors strong." These writings included other fabrications, such as that his men killed upwards of 500 Native Americans, or that they were well-armed and strategically sound in the first place. Of course, these were all intentional measures by Chivington to advance his political career, quiet the naysayers who called his cavalry bloodless, and take out his personal transgressions against the indigenous. Luckily, it would all soon be for naught, as the performative victory masqueraded by Chivington and company would soon be investigated by the United States Congress. Captain Silas Sewell and Lieutenant Joseph Kramer were quick to write to their own superiors in Washington, D.C. of the atrocities and unspeakable crimes they had witnessed in November of 1864. Other eyewitnesses felt the same disgust, and eventually Congress had to act. They launched an official investigation through the Joint Committee on the Conduct of the War, parallel to the military's own detective work. After weeks of investigating, the panel released a statement as follows. "As to Colonel Chivington, your committee can hardly find fitting terms to describe his conduct. Wearing the uniform of the United States, which should be the emblem of justice and humanity, holding the important position of commander of a military district, and therefore having the honor of the government to that extent in his keeping, he deliberately planned and executed a foul and dastardly massacre, which would have disgraced the veriest savage amongst those who were the victims of his cruelty. Having full knowledge of their friendly character, having himself been instrumental to some extent in placing them in their position of fancied security, he took advantage of their inapprehension and defenseless condition to gratify the worst passions that ever cursed the heart of man." Whatever influence this may have had upon Colonel Chivington, the truth is that he surprised and murdered, in cold blood, the unsuspecting men, women, and children of Sand Creek, who had every reason to believe they were under the protection of the United States authorities, and then returned to Denver and boasted of the brave deed he and his men, under his command, had performed. In conclusion, your committee are of the opinion that for the purpose of vindicating the cause of justice and upholding the honor of the nation, prompt and energetic measures should be at once taken to remove from office those who have thus disgraced the government by whom they are employed, and to punish, as their crimes deserve, those who have been guilty of these brutal and cowardly acts." Amongst those to testify was Captain Silas Sewell himself. However, it would be ultimately his final act of courage, as he was murdered by Charles W. Squires under the paid direction of John Shivington. Shivington himself would go unpunished, as he resigned from his military position before the congressional hearing convicted him of his crimes. While his political career was halted, he never faced real consequences for his actions, his legacy forged in history books as one of complexity and heroism, rather than for the dastardly final act of terrorism he committed. Really, the entire legacy of the Sand Creek Massacre itself was seen in a similar light. While folks along the eastern seaboard and the surrounding states were mortified by the events at Big Sandy Creek, many local Colorado residents felt emboldened by the massacre. They refused to see it for what it was, and these attitudes bled into the national context for decades. For the longest time, the horrors in eastern Colorado were referred to as the Battle of Sand Creek, as if there were two equal sides in conflict to begin with. Not only that, but the only efforts by Washington, D.C. to actually amend the atrocities with the Arapaho and Cheyenne were feeble at best, when the U.S. government signed the Little Arkansas Treaty. The treaty was meant to repay surviving Sand Creek victims with substantial cash reparations, as well as providing access to lands south of the Arkansas River to local tribes. Unfortunately, after 2 years, this treaty was disregarded by the U.S. government, and instead lumped into the Medicine Lodge Treaty that forged all remaining indigenous tribes to poorly resourced land in Oklahoma. This would result in a 90% decrease in land rights for the Cheyenne and the Arapaho when it was all said and done. In the years since, the efforts to change the conversation around the Sand Creek Massacre have improved, at least incrementally. A National Historic Site placard now sits at the remnants of the campsite, dedicated to the victims in 2007. In 2015, another memorial was constructed at the Colorado Capitol Building, with the governor of Colorado acknowledging the dark moment in the state's history. In 2022, nearly 3,500 acres of land were added to the Sand Creek Massacre site for preservation purposes, as a way to honor the descendants of both its victims and its survivors. In the public sphere, the discussion around Sand Creek remains divided. Some historians remained fixated on the idea that the massacre was justified, that the horrors detailed by Silas Sewell and others were either exaggerated or made up to justify the raids on white settlers occurring previous to the massacre itself. Others aren't as skeptical, but rather revolted and impassioned by the evils that plagued the Cheyenne and Arapaho before, during, and after the events of November 29, 1864. Ultimately, the fear of speaking out makes sense. It can be hard to look at an entity such as the United States Armed Forces, which has done so much good in the world, and think they could be responsible for such hateful, horrid actions. However, in the end, it's dark spots on history like the Sand Creek Massacre that force us to call out the senseless violence perpetrated against peoples in our own country. The Cheyenne and the Arapaho tribes did not deserve to be murdered in cold blood, but their stories do deserve to be told. If anything, to make sure the Sand Creek Massacre of 1864 is not forgotten, and to uphold the lessons we've all hopefully learned in the context of war.